메이커.
I don't believe there is anything that I love more than watching football. I'm addicted, totally addicted to the game. Sure, I mistook on the blood eating for the last 70 odd years, so I'm afraid I'll keep at it down till I go into the grave.
Oh, are you
Goodbye.
I saw you somewhere.
Your buddy. We could do with that fella today.
Why, Jess, you can see.
I miss days like today, though.
You would have got.
I don't be stuck out in the middle of it.
Nothing to equal New York there.
I'd like to be on the sideline watching or in the stand and drop dead. That's the way I'd like it to happen. I'd be quite happy if that happened. But not yet, I hope, for another while anyway.
Right now, it's Kerry attacking again. It is McGuire. McGuire with it now, shaking off Terry Cairns, getting inside the shot. Algie's running to the ball, and it's over the bar.
The amazing McGuire.
Kerry's chief scorer today, McGuire. He's got the ball, he shoots, and what a goal!
I packed everything I wanted to into the 82 years that I've spent in this planet. I've enjoyed every moment of it.
And all danger for Dublin there, the ball breaking loose on the wing, it's a goal! It's a goal by John Egan!
I've done everything I wanted to do. I did it all and got great enjoyment out of it, and I wouldn't change it for the world.
They truly are the kingdom of football.
I had a marvellous run, but I wasn't very lucky to be born in Kerry. My mother was born in an island off the southwest coast, an island by the name of the Scariff Island.
Gerald?
Yeah.
That is where your great-grandmother came from, that house up there in the hill.
How did they get themselves onto the island?
They skin on with a boat and walk up the cliff, not here now, on the other side of the island.
Where would they get money?
Where would they get money? By selling the butter and selling the cattle and selling the fish they caught in the sea. Money was scarce, but they had enough to eat, which was very important. If you have enough to eat, you live, you know, very important. Do you understand that? Good.
Did they make jam?
No jam. They didn't make any jam.
There was five families on the island at one stage, and my family were the last to leave it. The night my mother was born, my grandmother got into difficulty. There was no boat available to go ashore, so her husband had to jump into the sea and swim ashore about 3 miles away. I'd say he swam the English Channel if he had to, the same man. So he swam ashore and he got a doctor ashore, and I came out and my mother was delivered. And they made a decision there and then that they'd come ashore. And she was the only one of the family to be born on the island.
The wires came originally from West Cork. But I never admitted that, of course, when I was involved in football. But my father's people were fishermen, hunting men and shooting men.
Father, he was an exceptionally quiet man, most placid man I suppose you could ever meet. He fought in the Tan War and then he fought on the Republican side and in the Civil War. Never once did he mention the wars to me, never once. We could never understand it. Himself and four other men They moved into the caves up at the top of Loch Ron, which is the big lake here in Waterford. Just come out by night, and what damage they had to do, they did it by night. A bullet went through the beret he was wearing, but the hole where the bullet went through, he escaped. And I think there was about four or five men captured that night, and they were blown up after on a landmine. A lot of bad things happened, of course, which I suppose wouldn't be repeated. It would have been great if he had spoken about it. And, you know, he must have had a lot of stories to tell, which he never did. My father, God rest him, he was the man that purchased the first football and gave it to me. I was 7 years of age when I got it. And from the day that I got that ball, I never left it out of my hand. Day and night. I used to even take it to bed with me, would you believe it? So I got was a big thing that I think to have a football that were very scarce. So I made a decision then that this football should be paid for. I got fellas to play it. I was charging them a penny to play when they would be playing football. So we collected the price of another football. So then we had two footballs. But there'd be 30 fellas trying to play. Get a kick at that every evening, and that wasn't too easy, I can tell you. 1953, we cycled to Carcerine, got on the train. That was a famous ghost train, which is a steam engine. To be put on specially for the All-Ireland final. And just get into Dublin at 6 o'clock in the morning. It was our first time in Dublin. We had no clue where we were. We didn't want to go in the bus because we didn't know where the bus would take us. So we stayed on foot. But we walked all the ways up along the Liffey into O'Connell Street and up and into Crow Park. We were amazed with it, amazed. We had two tickets for Hill 16. That's how we watched it. Kerry won it. They were all Ireland champions.
It's Kerry's big day. With another crown for the kingdom, the curtain falls on a great day, everybody connected with which has a right to be proud.
In Kerry that time, South Kerry weren't rated as a footballing stronghold. And when we won the championship then, we had quite a number of players, including myself and Mico O'Connell and Morris's father, Ned Fitzgerald.
There are just two of the more familiar and famous faces. You can make that four with Bomber Liston and Ogie Moore, and they're sitting just behind Mick O'Dwyer and Morris Fitzgerald.
Morris Fitzgerald was an exceptional player. One of the great forwards of our time. He had everything going for him.
Oh, Jesus.
We go to the field here regularly. We'd have a big chat and we'd diagnose the whole thing.
Sheen will make the difference here today. Here he comes, here he comes. Look at this, look at this. Look at that for Paul, look at that. Look, look at that for Paul. Bang, hit him. That's this stuff.
Yes, that was some kick we got.
That was a great kick.
You take it easy.
Few come to games in Kerry town. A few good rattles is there.
Every spare moment I ever had, I spent it on football fields all over Ireland. I'm addicted, totally addicted to the game. I was addicted to driving as well, I suppose. When I left school, I wanted to get into the motor business as a trainee mechanic. To be able to get a drive in a car was a very big thing. The man who owned the garage wanted to get out of the business and he asked me would I buy it, which I did. It was £1,300. The very first car I bought was the Chevrolet by J.W. LeMove as well. going to Dublin to a game, and I managed to get her up to 180 miles an hour. I was a bit of a speed merchant. I could quite easily have gone into rallying instead of playing football. This was the highest notion in my head, to go to Killarney for the Rally of the Lakes. But word came out that I had been selected to play for Kerry. So I mentioned it to my father. He said to me, Mick, he says, you can always go rallying, but you might only get one chance to play for Kerry.
More than an hour before the start of the Senior All-Ireland football final between Munster champions Kerry and Connacht champions Galway, the gates of Croke Park were closed on a capacity crowd of nearly 86,000 people.
You think you're in another world completely. Nervous butterflies in the tummy, going out onto the pitch with the roaring of the crowd and all that. But it was a big occasion for me, coming from Waterville, being the first man ever from Waterville to play on any forum of a Kerry team. It's something that I will always remember.
And Mick O'Dwyer added this neat point. The sound of the final whisk was only the starting signal for the jubilant celebrations which the confident Kerry men had arranged before they even came to town.
Would you believe it, that everybody left the dressing room in Croke Park. Sam Maguire cup left in the table there. The following morning, the cup is missing. I wonder, would it be in under the Cusick stand in the dressing room? And there was the Sam Maguire sitting on the table. It was my job then to see after from there. So we took it back by car. I can assure you, it wouldn't happen today. The thing in Kerry, they say that we should be able to win two All-Irelands in every decade. We picked up one in 62.
Kerry, undoubtedly the premier county in football, had won their 20th title. And no one could say they had not richly deserved it.
I was in here on 21 occasions on All-Ireland Day as a selector and as a player. So I know Croke Park pretty well. A winning dressing room is the best dressing room in the world to be in. But in a losing dressing room, it's like a wake.
To give Galway a two-point lead. Now the destruction of the Kerry challenge started in earnest. Christy Tyrrell to Matty McDonagh. Another point.
Then to be beaten by Galway three times in the 60s. That didn't go down too well. So things were pretty bad in Kerry. I had plenty of injuries. I broke my two collarbones, broke my toe, had a compound fracture of the ankle, and did a knee a couple of times. Should have all these men now. There's about 20 of them now following a team around. In my time, we'd have a masseur, maybe, and a doctor, and that'd be it.
You're not the official.
No, I'm not the official. I'm not the official masseur at all. There's a few of them have come in, seven or eight of them, at various stages with minor injuries and some not so minor.
When I broke my two legs, did the ankle in one and did the fibula in the other. I was 29 at the time. I decided maybe it was time to pack it. But when I became a selector then on the Kerry team straight away, I just came up with that idea and I picked myself.
Once, Kerry made claims to a near monopoly of Gaelic football. Now, these claims have worn a little thin. Kerry have recalled players whose careers seemed over, and the players have responded unselfishly.
This is Waterville in South Kerry, home of Mick O'Dwyer, one of the players making a comeback, or who made a comeback this year. And of all the players who did come back to the Kerry team, Mick's, I think, was the most difficult choice. Anything wrong there, Mick?
No, there's nothing there, Val, that we can't solve anything.
Same with the Kerry team, I think. Tell me, Mick, why did you come back? And what was so difficult about it?
In the last 2 years, the team, haven't been doing too well. And I had been playing football myself with the local club here. And playing reasonably well. And so here I am back in an All-Ireland final and hoping to win it.
That was a great down team. I see as good a half-hour line as ever played the game.
And the game is on. And first to get it or down, it is James Milligan with the ball. Milligan 70 yards out to the Kerry goal, right down into full forward Sean O'Neill. Sean O'Neill with the ball 20 yards out. It's high and it's a point.
They beat us in 1960 in the final. And they came again in 68. And they beat us in 68 as well. Didn't go down too well, I can assure you. Then we picked up 170.
Once a half back, now a very effective forward.
I suppose the strongest part of my game was fielding. I was a marvellous fielder of the ball. And of course, when I played as a forward, it was very accurate.
Comes back to Micklethwaite. Micklethwaite quickly over the bar, and it's a point for Kerry, scored by Micklethwaite.
The players that played around me told me I was a very selfish player. And like Spillane, I'd say to them, why should I be giving it to you when I can score myself? I was top scorer in Ireland 2 years in succession.
Here stand Kerry, the real giants of championship football, proudly perched atop the scale of supremacy with 22 titles. Kerry, of course, are loaded with experience. One of their long-serving players, Mick O'Dwyer, has been in this situation before. This will be the 9th All-Ireland final for Mick O'Dwyer. Will it be the last?
Well, we'll take every game as it comes, but I'm considering retiring this year all.
But in Kerry, getting to finals is just not good enough. In other sports in this country, if you get to finals, it's a big thing. But living here in Kerry, it's a case of having to get to All-Ireland finals and win them.
Andy Fanning with it now, in towards the goal, not a high one, a lovely ball into the goal. It's a goal! Oh, yes, it's a goal! It's a goal!
But it is amazing, in that 12 years, we won 4 All-Irelands, and I think we lost 5. So then they'll tell you that was a bad period in Kerry football.
And Offaly have won the All-Ireland. Offaly have won their second All-Ireland. 2 in a row for Offaly.
When they packed up playing with Kerry, I decided fishing was to be my game from there on. I bought 140 lobster pots and I bought a boat. I was going to go fishing. And Gerald McKinney arrived and asked me to manage the Kerry Senior football team. So that finished me with my pots and my boats again. So from there, it was football and the fishing was put aside. Every moment that I spent inside in this stadium. I only wish we could rewind the clock, but that's not possible.
Oh, me, Jim.
I never sat down here on the sideline. I stood on the sideline with the program in my right hand. That's all I ever did. Up and down the line, roaring and shouting. I have the sign of it today, but however, it was worth every bit of it. Biggest days of all that I spent here, and the greatest years I spent here was when we played Dublin. And there's nothing better for a county than come into Croke Park, take on the Dubs, and play into the hill. There is satisfaction in that.
This is Croke Park, the grounds where legends are made. And we're told by experts that the turf, the pitch itself, is in superb condition. And indeed, tomorrow's match has got all the promise of any of the great historic finals.
If you haven't got a ticket, live coverage from RTE begins at 1:20 tomorrow, with a big match at 3:15.
In 1975, I took over And I made up my mind that I was going to build a team with youth from the word go, a team that I would have for at least 10 to 12 years. You see all these young fellas, they wanted to get on this Kerry team, and I worked ever so hard. We did 27 consecutive nights without a break, and not one player missed the training session. It was an ambush. We caught Dublin on the hop that day. There's no doubt about that.
Dublin playing with the slightest breeze in this first half. Kerry with the green and gold stripe on the side of their necks. And oh, danger for Dublin there. The ball breaking loose on the wing. It's a goal! It's a goal by John Egan.
Dublin, of course, had a great team. They were riding on the crest of a wave when we arrived. Mickey Ned won a ball around the middle of the field and he was flying through. He had passed about three Dublin players.
And here comes Kerry again. Mickey Sullivan going racing through. Gavin Larkin's in front of him. He's got past Gavin Larkin. Kenny Riley's after him. Georgie Wilson's after him. Everybody's after him. He's well and truly looked after now.
But I said to Mickey Ned, if I was playing fullback myself, I'd have done the very same thing. I think you should have released the ball quicker. He was concussed. He was taken away to hospital. Pat Spillan took over, 19, I think, at the time.
This is Pat Spillan. And they get a point for Kerry. Kerry coming back. And Dublin get a point. Back come Kerry. Young Pat Spillan.
Tremendous player. No end to him. A great skill. Marvellous kicker of the ball. The same man to go through a brick wall for you.
And the game is over.
And Pat accepted the cup.
Sullivan will have recovered to drink out of this cup tonight. Thank you.
Never shout the words the same, man, but I think he's a marvellous character.
We want Dwyer, is the call, and here he is.
And here's the man himself, Mick O'Dwyer, the trainer who has won so many medals himself and was very responsible for this victory. Mick, it was a tremendous display by Kerry.
Yeah, one of the best displays, Mick, I'd say, in the history of the association by our team. I had no doubt whatever that we're going to win this one.
But in 76, after winning 75, our fellas got a little bit lost. The Rose of Tralee was in full swing. I think they were dabbling in some of the niceties. They were young. The winter that had hit them more than anything. And Dublin came again in 76 and beat us. And beat us fair and square, to be honest.
Anton O'Toole being chased by Gerpard. Out on the far side, Bernard Brogan got up for him.
Kevin Heffernan. We weren't great pals, I can assure you. There was no big relationship between the two of us. We rarely shook hands or any of that stuff.
For Kevin Heffernan, did you expect it to be so easy?
Well, we knew we were going to win. I think we were very confident, at least, before we started. But if we'd lost today, I think we just might have begun to believe the myth that we couldn't beat Kerry.
But in Kerry, they're never happy, you know. They want to win our islands every year, and that's not possible. But we were so young at the time. We lost again in 77.
He's in front of the goal. He can't miss. He has.
But it looked like as if it was the end of the road for me. OBJ, they were after my head and they were after the chairman of the county board as well. The guns were out. But myself and the chairman, we put up a fight and we stayed on.
Dublin, 3 goals in 12. Kerry, 1 goal in 13. And what great rivals these two are.
After 77, we found a man by the name of the Bomber Liston. He was a nice, soft, pudgy little fellow when I got him. He was a great man for the Mars Bar and the package of Smarties and what have you. And by God, he had the sign of it.
And here's the man with the beard. He looks like Hollywood's version of a Quaker, but he's not. He's Owen the Bomber Liston.
But he lost about 5 stone weight. Night after night, here in Waterville, training. It made a big difference to the team. He was the missing link, I think.
This is all Liston. Pass the ball up. Jack O'Shea. Jack O'Shea. Right through
The Egan goal was the one that changed the game. And then Mikey's goal put the icing on the cake. Was an exceptional goal. He chipped Paddy Cullen. No question or doubt, that goal did change the history of Kerry football. We were beaten that day. They could quite easily have gone, and they might never have been involved with Kerry anymore. That was one of the greatest days of my life and the most enjoyable, I can assure you.
And Unlisted is in there. This was a Kerry team who came from nowhere. An amazing All-Ireland final.
We could say to people, no, we've done it. And it was amazing what happened after. Every time we went to play a game, we were nearly guaranteed to win. We never thought about defeat. We never looked at the other teams that we met along the line. We had 20 players who were good enough to win All-Ireland by playing a style of football that nobody could match. At one stage, I never even thought about it. It was just another All-Ireland coming, and I wasn't counting. I've been around over 80 years now, and I've seen a lot of players in my time. But 15 of those men that were on the field together, I don't believe you could get better at any period, at any time. It isn't because I was managing them or anything, it was because they were the best.
And there goes the final whistle, and Kerry have done it. Kerry have won 4 All-Irelands in a row, and they truly are the kingdom of football.
People of Kerry, let me say here tonight, you have seen nothing yet. It's already the start.
Any sponsorship that was coming had to go through Croke Park. We made a decision, it was about time for the players to get a little bit out of it. We made an agreement with Adidas at the time that they give £20,000 to a fund which we were organising to go on a world tour. So 20,000 was massive money at the time. But the association came down on us. We were fined £500 at the time for wearing the Adidas gear, but we had got 20,000, so it was a good deal. Them were the days, yeah. And we had a good time and we had a great tour.
The big news from the Kerry camp concerns sponsorship. The distributors of Bendix washing machines gave Kerry £10,000 in return for a photograph taken with this washing machine in the foreground.
They arrived in Tralee from Dublin with a van with a washing machine in it, brought it into the dressing room, and when we finished training, players put their jerseys into the washing machine. And that was the photograph, that was the paper the following day. They were all standing around half clothed, but we got something in the region of about 15,000. That was the start of sponsorship by the counties. And Croke Park were going on over that as well, but I didn't give a damn, which is amazing. It was a forerunner for many things to come after. I was a player myself, I was a player's man, and I finished being a player's man.
Thank you.
ourselves just after when I finished. And I finished in 74. I was top scorer in Ireland that year. I got a nomination, but I wasn't selected. But I was 38 years of age. I suppose that came against me as well. And being the top scorer in Ireland, I suppose majority of people thought I should have got an All-Star. But we had to wait in for a number of years until my son, Cal, got one. But he reminds me fairly regularly about that. And I got everything, but I didn't get an All-Star.
Kerry stand at the edge of football history tomorrow when they bid for 5 All-Ireland titles in succession. And that, as you know, is an achievement unparalleled in the history of Gaelic football. 24 hours for Kerry to confirm their reputation as the greatest Gaelic football team in the history of the game.
Nobody anticipates that this marvellous team, still under the care of the astute Mick O'Dwyer, will stumble at this stage of the record bid.
There was terrible hype then, of course, when they came to going on to try and win the 5 in a row. And the hype in Kerry itself was unbelievable. They were bringing out mugs and cups and saucers and everything, which printed on it for Kerry's 5 in a row.
John Donovan, who signs himself a loyal Offaly supporter, was aghast at an advertisement in a local Kerry paper for the entertainment in a Tralee hotel. It advertised a victory dance for Sunday night, but says Mr. Donovan, that ad appeared 4 days before the finals played. And maybe the moral is don't go to Kerry on your holidays the week before the All-Ireland final.
I love the sense of, the casual sense of Kerry, really.
We were so near and so close, it was unreal.
That's Pat Spillane. And there is a penalty, or is there? No, the referee waved the play on. Now he's given the penalty.
We were 5 points up at the time. If we had scored, we'd have gone 8 points up and the game would have been over.
Mikey Sheehy, the anxiety, the importance of this kick. 5 in a row they're bidding for. Mikey Sheehy to take the kick. Martin Furlong in the goal. He saved it! He saved it! Oh, Martin, what a save! With 2 minutes left in the game, Kerry leading by 2 points.
Time nearly up. Everything looked great. A high speculative kick from Connor, the fullback.
A high lobbing, dropping ball in towards the goal. A shot! A goal!
Bang! Back of the net. Game over. A little nudge made history.
Finals I have ever seen. Kerry cruising to victory, and then it was on the cards all the time that that goal would come.
If you were well beaten, you'd be happy enough. But I mean, we were so close. I felt sick. For 2 months after, I never left Waterville. I stayed in the house, put the tape in and had a look at it, and just saying to myself, pity we didn't do this, pity we didn't do that. It's like a death in the family, if that's possible.
The game really needed that, and I'm delighted that it was Offaly that defeated us when we were to be beaten. Keep up the good work. We'll be back again next year to meet you in the final.
I think of it at least once a week. It's still implanted in my mind. It's the wedding day, yeah. Not too bad. Paul Gallivan said yes. If I was around now, he'd have me as a model. Never bought a suit in my life. My wife bought them. I wore them. Yeah, time flies. Flies. We lived next door to one another, 3 houses up the road, that's all. I had the car and she asked me for a lift down home. And I gave her a lift and that was that. We were together when we were together for 50 years after. But she, luckily enough, she ran the scene while I was around the country. We were apart most of the time. I suppose that's how it lasted.
By the way, your wife, Mary Carmel, won't talk to me at all. And I don't know why. It's either that she hates me or she hates television. Do you go to all the games with them? I suppose you do.
Never gone to a match.
You have never gone to a match?
No.
What sort of a wife are you at all?
Somebody has to stay at home.
Well, this is true. And he doesn't give out?
No. I'd say he's glad.
She passed away then about 4 years ago. God, you miss somebody like that, all right. It was always there. No matter where you travel, she'd be there when you'd come home. All alone, yeah. Four lads are gone. So people build big houses, and at the end of the day, they don't need them. I used to play the accordion. I have much use of my left hand now, so I can't play that either now. That's gone as well. The golf and the accordion is gone. I'm okay. Still catch a high ball if it's just coming. Punch it, yeah, it's okay. I have a bit of a tough time putting on the stockings in the morning, but that's the age, just you. Can't escape. I was an awful man for roaring and shouting and encouraging players on the pitch. This is the one thing that affects me quite a bit. When I come and go, some days I don't be able to speak at all. 1982 was the year we lost the final in a row. We came back after to win three more in a row.
Still the bomber! It's high!
But we got a few players and that team was amazing. A little fresh injection of players made all the difference.
Yes!
Mikey Sheehy dodging round two defenders. Lovely balance, brilliant skill and control. Ogie Moran now can Owen Liston finish off what has been a perfect move. He can.
I said inside the dressing room, but we were going to win this All Ireland today for one man, and that is Mick Doyle! Shadow of a doubt that he will go down in the folklore of football history.
That was a real good finish. You know, only for losing the two in the middle there, we could have won nine All-Irelands in a row. They were an exceptional bunch of men, the likes we won't see again, in my opinion. The wind-up of that team. They were gone past it at that stage, but they didn't want to let go, so they did continue for a few years, but they got nowhere, to be honest. And there was a deadness and a soreness about the whole thing. And I made up my mind there and then, that it was over. Little did I know that Kildare would come calling, and I would answer that call. Here is where we really found out whether players were good enough to play for Kildare or not. Brave heart, Hill they call it, and you needed a brave heart to be able to run it. We'd start from here, straight up, you can see the paddler going to the very top, up around the trees and back down to me. There was one fella, he was hiding the trees, and I caught him. I said nothing. But he didn't last too long after I got a few sessions after he was gone.
My steady pace now all the way.
It was rumoured heavily that I was being chartered around in a helicopter into Kildare for training sessions, and I was getting 100,000 and 50,000 and all that kind of old talk. And I had an old crock of a Mercedes, so when I arrived in the Bangor, I think they just couldn't believe what was happening. I kept a good one at home and I put a bad one on the roll. I didn't intend to come here to Kildare at all in the start. I mean, how low could you have gone? They played Kilkenny in the Auburn Cup, I think about 6 weeks before I came, and Kilkenny beat them. I didn't think that they'd be capable of winning it as the title at that stage.
Who's got the courage now to dig really deep? It's going to take something special. Martin Lynch is a player loose inside. Here it comes from Brian Murphy. It's a goal! And it's a goal! And it's Brian Murphy who's got it! Carol O'Dwyer belting it into space. Now they're all confident. Now they're champions. Look at this for celebration. Carol O'Dwyer, he was one of the key parts of the jigsaw that Mikko put together. Champions for the first time in 42 years.
My son Callum is really involved in the St. Lawrence's Club here in Kildare. My wife, God rest her, she didn't like it when he came to Kildare. She said it was the cause of bringing him here. But I suppose in a way I was. He played minor in under 21 for Kerry and played senior as well, but they dropped him then. But I don't think he got fair play in Kerry, to be honest. But I knew well that there was plenty of football in him.
There's a mass outpouring of joy at Croke Park. Centre stage this afternoon, Mick O'Dwyer, who of course coached Kerry to 8 All-Ireland titles, won 4 All-Ireland medals himself, and now here he is with the Leinster champions. Beautiful ball, Carol O'Dwyer. His native county, kicking, and he scores. The referee whistles and it's all over. Kildare have dethroned the champions and reached the All-Ireland final for the first time since 1935. Glenn Ryan has been a magnificent captain this afternoon.
In Kerry now, when you're in an All-Ireland final, you rarely see a flag. That'd be pretty scarce. But in Kildare that year, everywhere was awash with white. They weren't excited at all, they were crazy. I never saw anything like it in my life. You couldn't go to any village or town or anywhere in the county, but there was bunting flying in all directions.
Checking the watch. Gets underway. Crowd roaring on their encouragement, dropping it in there towards Corrick Joyce. Joyce having this chance to put Galway ahead.
The hype that went down in Kildare for that All-Ireland final was unreal. I suppose it had an effect on the players, there's no doubt about it.
Score for Galway, and that's another one.
That was a very good Galway side.
Galway are the
All-Ireland
champions from 1998.
In any sport you're in, you want to get to the very top and play in the big day. Those Kildare players got that opportunity, and I think they'll never forget it.
Very welcome.
You've turned to the horses. In a big way.
Do you know Anto?
Mick, how are you?
How are you?
Not too bad. He was always a horse himself, wasn't he?
Nice shot, Seven, but he met you first.
That's right. I could have been a jockey, Mick.
You could have been, yeah.
You have a sweet tooth, Mick.
Very much so.
Well, we have special bars here now. I call them jockey bars. They're only half the size of normal bars. Because the jockeys can't eat the full size.
Oh, be gee.
They suit you.
This is big enough.
Is it?
I think I remember when Nico came first, he had 50 or 60 lads in the training. And we possibly would have trained for 20 nights in a row. And at the end of that 20 nights, he had probably 25 to 30 guys left because guys just had faded away because the training was so hard.
Wouldn't he run us? We'd be running after him. And you'd be laughing in the middle.
There were purgatorial runs more so than anything else.
I trained the horses the same way you trained us.
There's only one way, work.
Work is right, yeah. Exactly, and they love it.
And the horses love it too much.
Yeah.
It's just over great times until then.
They were actually. Just haven't been the same since. Like, he brought to Kildare success, and he brought respect to Kildare football that wasn't before, and he literally brought a handicapping horse up nearly to try and nearly win a Group 1.
For 30 years, I suppose. I took on the role of an undertaker for quite a number of years. I bought a pub and turned it into a hotel. I bought a fast food place and a supermarket.
I've a nice little cotton, the small bits of land, in a place by the side of the sea. Come on, Michael.
I loved it. I love country music. I'd be a bit of a country music band, all right. I loved it. Brendan Shine was my favourite. I was on television with Brendan Shine.
Do you want your old puppy washed down? Do you want your old puppy washed down?
I went on then and bought another hotel down the street and ran a big entertainment scene there. There's 600 people in here every Sunday night. And they played all the big bands in the country. Joe Dolan played here, Brendan Shine played here, and no matter where I'd be with Kerry, I drove all the ways back to do the bouncing in the hall, and my two sons ran the bar. So I tried my hand at lots of things.
A new year, a new team, same old ambitions for Mick O'Dwyer. The veteran manager in good form ahead of Leash's first competitive outing of the season.
When I went to Leash, I changed the whole system of training there. Put in a lot of hard work, did a lot of rounds of the pitch and did a few wire-to-wires and played a lot of football. Leash hadn't won for over 60 years when I went there. And we got the three Leinster finals in a row.
Great Leinster final. McDonald, 2-3. It's still McDonald has a loose ball outside. Chance to finish it off here. What an explosive ball.
They were a good footballing side. And if we could have got a bit of extra effort, we might have gone the whole way. Some of them there after 3 years thought that the system I had wasn't the right stuff, that I should change it and what have you.
Not a normal training session by any means. Behind closed doors, Mick O'Dwyer addressed a crucial players' meeting. It's understood O'Dwyer looked for an increased commitment from the panel. On leaving, the normally talkative Mick O was remaining tight-lipped. Mick, he's still Leash manager.
The only one that talks, you know, is the chairman. The chairman. So instead of changing it, I left. And I got change and it didn't take him any further. I didn't win since.
It's amazing what one man can do for the hopes and aspirations of Wicklow, one of the three counties in the country, never to have still won a provincial senior football title. Mick O'Dwyer, advising, cajoling, inspiring.
I tell you one thing, I miss some of the greatest GAA people in Wicklow. There's a hunger for success there. We won the Murphy Cup, which was an achievement in itself. I was 75.
Come on, Russ!
A lot of people in Offaly said to me, did they ever think about leaving Waterville? I toured Australia. And I toured the United States. I was around the world a couple of times, and I always wanted to get back to Kerry. If I was traveling up the country and if I saw a football match on, I'd stop and have a look at it, even though I'd have no connection whatsoever with it. when they drive through the village of Waterhill, I'll always call to the football field, drive in the gate and have a look. The very last team that I managed was an under 14 team here 2 years ago. I was 79. And we went on to win the league. So I said, when that happened, the wheel has gone right around now. So that was the last team I managed. And unless they'll manage one up above, if there is football to be played there, we'll wait and see. Keep going now, keep going. This is, of course, old age. I always say the youth is wasted in the young. Because it is now we should be able to move about, but that's the way with life. We all come into the world the same way, and guaranteed we'll all go out the same way. In life, to be honest, I will say that without fear of contradiction. I packed everything I wanted to into the 82 years that I've spent on this planet. I've enjoyed every moment of it. To do, I did it all and got great enjoyment out of it, and I wouldn't change it for the world.
If you're feeling inspired by some of the extraordinary athletes you've just been watching, then join us for all new series of Operation Transformation tomorrow and Wednesday at 8:30 here on One. Next this evening, Claiborne Live returns. That's more of that in just a moment.